Morning, everyone.
Morning, morning.
Lovely to see you all here this morning. Welcome to our service. Some faces I don't recognise. So I'm Andy. I'm one of the regular attenders here. So I'll be doing the first bit of the service. And then Stuart, who was here a couple of weeks ago, is back again. Can't keep him away. He'll be leading the sermon and taking us through communion as well. Why don't we open in prayer this morning? Lord, thank you on this second Advent Sunday that as Stuart was praying out in the lobby. We come here voluntarily to worship you this morning, Lord. We're not being forced to do this, but we just want to come and worship the Creator and Saviour of our souls, Lord. And I pray that through everything that happens this morning, that you'll just be with us, speak to each one of us, particularly through the service that Stuart's prepared. And just give us something to meditate on as we approach this Christmas season. I ask these things in your name. Amen. I feel quite echoey, Roo. I don't know. Do I sound echoey or am I not too bad? No, good. It's probably just my ears. It'll be fine. Right then, let's start by singing a carol. Got a couple of carols to sing this morning because I thought second Sunday of Advent, why not? And we're going to sing O Little Town of Bethlehem. Okay, notices. I thought when I started this morning, we didn't have many notices, but they've been gradually trickling in. So bear with me. First of all, Chris would like to say a thank you. Chris.
Yeah, thank you, Andy. Just to say on behalf of food.gibbs, they were really impressed with the amount that got taken up there. There's 12 boxes of food gone out to Ukraine, and I'm talking about sensible sized boxes of food, along with medical stuff, bedding, and other things. And they just say, thank you. So, yeah, thank you. And thank you to the Stevens family for all his hard work bringing the box backwards and forwards because I wasn't about.
Thank you, Chris. Claire wanted to say something.
Mine is literally 30 seconds. So this is a notice from the Family Community Worker Project leadership team, or the management committee. Sadly, Sharon has been signed off sick due to personal circumstances until mid-January. We apologise for the short notice, particularly in the run-up to Christmas. All activities are covered, and we will brief you in more details in the fullness of time. We are assured the situation has no reference to the Family and Community Project or the recent management restructure. We'll be keeping Sharon in our prayers at this time. If you have any questions or concerns regarding the project, please speak directly to Reverend Paul Smith. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Claire. So let's keep Sharon in our prayers, everyone. Okay, then a few other quick ones to go through. Reminder that we're looking for two male leaders, that's right, isn't it, in the February Church Council elections. There are nomination slips out in the lobby. Please pray and nominate who you feel that God is calling to be a leader in the church. Thank you. There is the Walk Around Nativity next Sunday. So Paul Smith will be speaking in the morning. And 5 o'clock in the afternoon is next Sunday, isn't it, Dan? Good, I'm not ahead of myself. Is the Walk Around Nativity. 5 o'clock here, stations around the village. There will be cakes, which I think Sylvia is coordinating. So if you've got a tray bake or cakes, you can contribute, speak to Sylvia. Anything else you need, Dan, for the nativity?
Tell your friends.
Are any of those little leaflets left?
There's something around that.
Okay. Yeah. So just spread the word and invite everyone along to the nativity. It's going to be a good afternoon. And the kids will be practicing this morning. Most of the notices have been on the screen. There was an error in the timing for the prayer meeting, which Jen has asked me to point out. It's 7:30, not 7 o'clock, as was on the screen. So, well, you can come early and pray for an extra half an hour, but you might be sat outside in the car if you do. And finally, just to say thank you to everyone who organised the Prime and Edge Christmas party, which was held here on Friday. We didn't count everyone, but we think there was about 60 kids from across the community. So that would include people from out towards Cobblestone, a lot from Mortchard Bishop area, this area, and quite a few ending up here from Witheridge as well. So really good that Prime and Edger have got that kind of reach into the community. And thank you to everyone who cooked or led or took part in that. And I think that is it, unless anyone tells me otherwise. No, fantastic. Right, I haven't forgotten about the candles, so don't get worried. We're going to weave them into this little bit of talk. Okay. So, Rue, can I have my image up? Fantastic. Who recognises one of those? Who's got one similar at home? Well, James, yeah, you do. Few? Who's got an advent calendar at home? Yeah, oh, now all the hands are going up. No adults. Oh, no, Linda's got one. Yeah, a few adults. Yeah, Louisa's got one. I haven't got one this year. My mum always used to buy me one, but she stopped a few years ago. It's disappointing. How many of you have got chocolate inside your advent calendar? Linda's got chocolate in hers. Yeah, Julia. All the kids do. Is that your advent chocolate? He brought it with him this morning. Fantastic. We do that, exactly that, in ours. So holding up a chocolate coin. So that's why we've got these pockets in ours, because we put the the Cadbury chocolate coins in, which is bigger than just the little tiny doors. And we can reuse this as well. It's really good. Oh, and for those of you who want these things, we've got a nativity set. So as the advent calendar goes through, we populate the nativity set in the run-up to Christmas. So we're in the second week of Advent. Last Sunday was the first week of Advent. This Sunday marks the start of the second week of Advent. What does Advent mean, kids? Do you know? Oh, go on. Yes, also. Run up to Christmas, yes. Do you know what the word actually means? If we're celebrating the Advent of something, what do you think Advent means? Adults. We use the word, don't we? But none of us think about what it actually means. Sorry, Shelley? The coming, yes. Yes. Literally, apparently it comes from Latin. I only know this because I looked it up. And ad and vent means literally to come. So an advent is looking forward to the arrival of something. It could be an object, could be an activity. But in this case, we're looking forward to the arrival of baby Jesus, aren't we? So that's why we celebrate Advent. Officially, I don't know if this applies to Methodism. I've no idea because I didn't come from a Methodist background. But officially, it's the first season in the Christian calendar. And then after Advent, we move through into Easter, where we remember the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And then that cycle carries on for the rest of the year and then starts again each Christmas. So it happens every 12 months. So almost in some ways, Advent isn't just looking forward to Christmas itself, but it's that looking forward Christmas and then the promise that Jesus would come and die on the cross at Easter so that we could have that relationship with him. And then also looking forward, tenuous link here to Stuart's sermon later, looking forward to the final coming of Jesus when he comes back again and all the stuff that's described in Revelation. So Stuart's going to be talking about Revelation later in the letter to the seven churches. But it's important that Advent isn't just a focus on Christmas, but it's wider than that. Can any of you remember what the first Advent candle stood for that we lit last week? Go on. Hope, yes, fantastic, well done. Why don't you come up here? Do you want to light the candles? It's always dangerous letting kids light candles, but anyway, we'll be fine. Does anyone know what the second Advent candle stands for? Peace, it is peace. So we're going to light two Advent candles this morning, one for joy and one for peace. And each of the four candles represent gifts that God's come and given to us. So we're going to light these two at the front, okay? Right. And in a minute, I'll read out the Advent reading for this morning. But do you want me to light it or do you want to light it? You want to light it. Go on then. Put your fingers back a bit further. Right there. Do you want me? There you go. Blow that out without blowing the candles out. Perfect. Well done. Thank you. Right, let's read out this morning's reading. So, as we said, we're lighting the second candle, which stands for peace. In days when God's people longed for peace, Isaiah declared, "Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she's received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins." That's from Isaiah chapter 40, verse 1. "We who gather together today also seek comfort and peace, yet we are unsatisfied with ideas of peace that tell us to keep quiet and go with the flow. We long for real peace, true peace, just peace. We wait as people who yearn for peace that bears the fruit of community, equity, and flourishing for all. We light these candles as a sign of God's shocking hope and just peace. May they be beacons calling us to repent and to live the good news of Jesus Christ as we wait and watch and labour for the day when all people can gather together to worship and glorify God. Amen." We're going to sing a more modern carol now that kind of relates to that reading as well. And it's "Joy Has Dawned Upon the World." And our kids, if you want to go out after we've sung this, thank you.
Joy has dawned upon the world, promised from creation, God's salvation now unfurled. Hope for every nation, not with fanfares from above, not with scenes of glory, but a humble gift of love, Jesus born of Mary. Sounds of wonder fill the Prince of Life shelters in a stable, hands that set each star in place, shape the earth in darkness, cling now to a mother's breast, fun vulnerable and helpless. Shepherds bow before the Lamb, gazing at the glory, gifts of men from distant lands. Prophesy the story. Gold, a king is born today. Incense, God is with us. Myrrh, his death will make a way, and by his blood he'll win us. Son of Adam, son of Ham, given as a ransom, reconciling God and man, Christ our mighty champion. What a Saviour, what a friend, what a glorious mystery. Once a babe in Bethlehem, now the Lord of history.
Good luck in your practice. I'm looking forward to it next week. Dan's probably thinking next week's come round far too quickly. Okay, we're going to enter into a time of prayer now. I'll start and I'll finish, and I'll leave a time in the middle for you to bring up any thanks or requests for God that you want to. I was particularly struck this morning when I was thinking about the second candle for peace, that we've got a lot of war and conflict going on in the world this morning. So it'd be really great if we could pray for God's intervention into those situations. Often we feel very helpless as individuals because these things are happening, or Ukraine's fairly close, isn't it? But a lot of these things are happening a long way away, and we don't know what influence we can have. But God can change things and does change things if we ask him to. So let's just have a time of prayer now. Lord, we thank you that, as it says in the Bible, we can cast our burdens onto you and you make them light, Lord, that you answer every prayer and listen to every prayer and request that we bring. We just pray that in this short time this morning that we have in prayer, that we'll just cry out to you in our hearts, cries of thanks, cries of petition, cries of worship, Lord, either out loud or in the silence, and in the confidence that you will listen and that you will act in the best interests according to your will. So let's just have a time now where we can do that. Lord, I thank you that the prayers that we've said in the silence, Lord, that none of us can hear, but you have heard. We just leave those with you, Lord. I just pray for, in particular, for those who can't be with us for whatever reason today, whether they're visiting or they're ill, Lord, that you'll just be with them and still have that real sense that they're valued and loved members of our community, Lord. And pray particularly for Sharon as well, that you'll just heal her with whatever's going on in her situation so that she can be back among us soon. As we said about the conflict in Gaza, Ukraine, many African states all over the and many others places in the world, Lord, that you just intervene somehow and bring that peace. I know that it won't fully arrive until you come again, but anything you can do in the meantime just to stop the suffering and the hurt that's going on in those conflicts, Lord, please do so. Pray that you'll be with Stuart as he comes to preach to us in a bit, and that you'll speak through him with your voice for each one of us today. We ask these things in your name. Amen. We're going to sing again before Stuart does come. We're going to sing Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. And then I'll hand over to Stuart. Thank you, Stuart.
Good morning to you all. I don't know what you've done wrong. Obviously, somebody is not very happy with you at all. To have me twice in 3 weeks, you can't get much worse. If you continue with this behaviour, I may be back. I want to attempt to try something totally different this morning. The last time I really did this was many, many years ago when I was part of a conference. And I spoke then for about an hour and a half, which I'm not allowed to do this morning, I've been told. Andy says he might get upset. I want us to have a drone's eye view of the letters to the seven churches this morning the seven churches in Revelation. And what the risen Lord says, said to them, is so, so important for us here in Mid-Devon in the 21st century. So if you'd like to open your Bibles, which are on your seats, and at Revelation chapters 2 and 3, so you can refer to what I say when we get there. I better turn mine to Revelation, not Psalms as well. In the book of Revelation, four things, I believe, are revealed uniquely. Firstly, when Jesus returns, which he will do, he will come to judge both the living and the dead. And when he comes, he will bring retribution. Forget this cozy little baby in a manger. Forget any candy floss stuff. When Jesus comes again, he will bring retribution. However, secondly, when he comes, he won't bring just retribution, he's also going to bring reward as well. Praise him. I think thirdly, in Revelation, we get a brief look at of Jesus recreating or reinventing, as it were, the entire universe, making a new heaven and a new earth, where it says in Revelation 21, there will be no more tears, no more death, no more mourning, nor crying, nor pain, because the former things have passed away. How fantastic is that going to be? Fourthly, and most importantly, when Jesus comes again, he won't be wearing a crown of thorns, but a crown of royalty. And he'll be reigning forever and ever. Oh, to stand before him, stand before the risen Christ and sing that wonderful song, crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon the throne. See, right at the beginning of his revelation, Jesus addresses seven letters to seven churches in Asia Minor, which is now Turkey. And each letter declares both the positives and the failings of the recipient churches and warns each congregation to repent. A warning I think we should indeed heed in 21st century Mid-Devon, or the heart of Devon, I believe, as your OHP says. And as we look at these seven churches, maybe we can consider where we are here in Heal Lane. How are we responding? How are we responding to what the Lord is telling us to do? That is for you to decide and pray about. See, the Revelation 7 churches were among several early Christian communities in Asia Minor, and these particular churches may have been chosen to receive Christ's message because geographically the churches were located along an established trade route. They brought together the most populous and influential parts of the province, and once the message was given in one of the churches, then it would have spread quite rapidly to the others as well. Okay, so although the seven letters in Revelation are tailored to the named churches, these churches, these individual churches, can symbolise, I think, all churches in one respect or another. So as I said, let's take heed and listen with wisdom. Firstly, then, the Church of Ephesus. I'm doing this because I can't reach any higher. That's in verses 2 to 7. Ephesus was the fourth largest church in the Roman of the Roman Empire in the first century. It was on the main sea part of Asia, and I suppose that its equivalent here in the UK would be somewhere like Liverpool. Okay? The majority of the trade from the East and from India and China came through Ephesus and were shipped on from there. So commercially, it was mega. It was also a religious centre, with a great temple of Artemis or Diana there, which towered over the whole city, saying, here I am, come and worship me. in around the temple, folk used to sell little idols which represented Diana. And if you remember, it was here in Acts 19 that Paul put them out of business. And riots ensued after that. As far as morality went, Ephesus was the pits. And the best summary that I've heard about Ephesus is that it was the Vanity Fair of Asia. In Revelation, whilst Jesus commended the Ephesian church for enduring hardships and hating the heresy of the Nicolaitans, who were all early Gnostics, who they wanted to blend Christianity with pagan practices like sexual immorality and say, it's all okay, as long as you believe that, then you can do whatever you want. But others in Ephesus had regretfully abandoned the love that they had at first. Verses 4 to 5 says, remember, therefore, from where you have fallen. It's like a plea from the risen Christ to the church. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. Things is the lesson in the letter to Ephesus teaches us the truth, just teaches us that love and truth must go hand in hand. And a church that tries, what's the term, congregational harmony at the expense of truthful teachings is way out of line. Instead, Jesus reveals that a church fashioned in his image must teach God's truth in love. The second church in Smyrna, verses 8 to 11, it was a cultured city. There was a stadium there, there was a library there, and also a monument to one of my friends, Homer. Not that I knew Homer, obviously, when he was here. He was born there, and it still stands there in the middle of the town. Now, problems that the early Christians had was that long before Christ was born, the Romans who lived there worshipped the emperor as if he was a god. Here was a city that was full of earthly pride and honour. So when this little church was founded there, it was going to be despised. It was going to be criticised and ultimately persecuted. So regretfully in Ephesus, the hassle came from both the Romans and the Jews, who didn't want this new religion on their doorstep. And for a Christian living in Smyrna at the time, life was pretty frightening. We might think we get the mickey taken out of us, or people mock us if they know we've been to church, we believe in Jesus, we speak his name. Nothing compared to what it was then. In fact, the early church father Polycarp, he was a bishop there, and he was also, as a matter of interest, a disciple of the Apostle John. And at the age of 86, Polycarp was burnt at the stake for refusing to renounce his faith in Jesus Christ. Some of Polycarp's words were, "For 86 years I have been his servant, and he has done me no wrong. How can I blaspheme my King, who saved me?" Jesus' words to the believers there encouraged them in the face of upcoming persecution. What in verse 10? "Don't fear what you're about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, that you may be tested. And for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life." This is the King of Kings is talking. This is the risen Christ. He can say this. He don't tell porkies. And indeed, not only Smyrna, but across the entire region, first century believers who resisted the pressures of imperial cult worship had to endure this persecution. Sometimes people put to death and tortured. Other times it's economic, like the loss of a job or being thrown out of their homes. And probably for this reason, Jesus reminded them that they are spiritually rich, even though materially poor. Christ doesn't reprimand this church, but instead he warns them of impending imprisonment for some of its members, urging them to remain faithful. I suppose, like the Church of Smyrna, Christians are still persecuted worldwide today, aren't they? In obvious and insidious ways. And Andy sort of made reference, I think, in our prayers. That stuff is going on out there. They need our prayers today. And this letter warns all Christians that although we might suffer greatly, the length of tribulation will be short compared to the promise of eternal life. Our third city, Pergamum, or Pergamos, as it says on there, in verses 12 to 17. I've said this is the church that compromises its beliefs. See, Pergamum was a principal city of the Roman Empire in the first century, and even now, seemingly, you can still see a theatre built into the steep side of the hill. The temple of the Roman Emperor Trajan was used for worship. And some think that, along with other ideas, this is why Jesus called Pergamum the place where Satan has his throne. It's where Satan can actually use people and bring them into his own sphere. Pergamum was renowned for its pagan practices, and amongst many other dangers, it was the centre of worship for the Greek god Asclepius. Can we have a quick one, please? There he is. Don't really recognise this. This is the badge of the Royal Army Medical Corps, actually. You noticed there's a pole in the centre. And who's that going round the pole? Asclepius. That's the old pagan god of healing and was worshipped in Pergamum. In fact, it became the lords, as it were, of the ancient world, and people came there, they travelled to be healed. And healing did take place. Look, please, let's not be naive about this. Satan can and does heal. He can mimic most things. And if we start looking at spiritual gifts, then please remember that Satan can and does bestow his gifts on and within folks as well as our Lord. The Holy Spirit's gifts encourage us, they enable us to bring others to know Christ. Satan's gifts brings a sense of self-satisfaction, sense of self-piety. Holy Spirit gifts are tools which help bring us to heaven. Satan's gifts will only lead us to hell. The letter to the Church of Pergamum applauds the congregation for upholding its faith despite all the stuff that's going on around them. And he did commend the few who stood strong and didn't renounce their faith, even when their friend Antipas was killed. But then his letter has some serious warnings. Some of those Christians had fallen away from his teaching in order to embrace sinful behaviour in their religious and moral compromise. If they didn't repent, Jesus tells them in verse 16, he himself would come and fight against them. However, those who do repent will be given hidden manna. Remember the manna from heaven? It's also mentioned in Psalm 78, 24. They were given a white stone or a clean slate with a new identity in Christ. I think, like the Christians there, it's easy, isn't it, to normalise the non-Christian behaviour of our culture and allow that behaviour to dilute our values. But the Bible urges us, Romans 12, verse 2, not to conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewal of our mind in accordance with God's word. Next, we have the next, well done, ahead of me. We have the city of Thyatira, verses 18 to 29, which I entitled the church that follows false prophets. In the book of Acts, Lydia was a wealthy benefactress and a convert to Christianity, wasn't she? She was a seller of purple cloth, and her original home was the city of Thyatira. The ancient coins there, they show a multitude of guilds, including linen weavers, bronze workers, potters and bakers. And these guilds were not good. Because if you were a tradesman, if you were doing something, you had to belong to a guild. Otherwise, you wouldn't get any business. They were like secret societies. And there are secret societies even today. And Christians say they belong to, well, they won't admit it, but they belong to secret societies. And it's the same damaging effect. In John's vision, Jesus is described with feet like burnished bronze, a metaphor that the citizens there would have easily grasped because of its bronze workers. They could connect. And he warned them there, those who were tolerating the deceptive teachings of Jezebel that led people into Satan's deep secrets. Few there have remained true to the faith. And Jesus encouraged them to hold on. He promised them authority over nations to those who persevere to the end. The Lord reminds us in this revelation, verse 33, that he will repay each of us according to our deeds. The payment for sin is death. However, those who persevere in faith will receive a share of Christ's messianic authority over all nations and triumph over death. I think just as some in the church there were led astray by false prophets, even today, Christians fall prey to occult leaders, occult practices and other false teachings. And to share in Christ's victory, we must avoid these so-called deep secrets of Satan and hold firm to Christ's teaching. Our next church, the fifth church, this is the Church of Sardis. We're on our way south now. The church that is spiritually dead. At the time of John's vision in Revelation, Sardis was one of the wealthiest Roman cities, despite having to be rebuilt several times after devastating earthquakes. And Jesus' words in Revelation sliced through Sardis's thriving health to the church's spiritual realities. Although there were a few faithful, most people in the Sardis church were spiritually dead and dying. And Christ told them to wake up, remember, repent. See, Sardis was a city that endured two surprise attacks despite its many fortifications. And Jesus faults the church of Sardis for maintaining an outward appearance, and this applies to our churches today, of being alive whilst being spiritually dead. And alluding to the city's history of prior surprise attacks, I think this is the reason why Jesus warns them to wake up and repent, lest he comes like a thief to bestow his judgment. Those in the Church of Sardis who heed Christ's warnings will be dressed in white. It's a symbol of purity and victory, and it will be acknowledged in heaven's book of life. I think Christians can fall into the trap, can't they, that ensnared the church in Sardis. If we just merely go through the motions of practicing our faith. You know, yeah, I go to church on a Sunday, it's great. You know, the preacher was pretty rubbish today, the preacher was not quite good, whatever. We can practice our faith without feeding our spirit. And we can avoid becoming the living dead, as it were, by engaging our faith through Bible study, prayer, fellowship, and getting out there, meeting people and being Christ, the folks that we meet out there. Second to last is the Church of Philadelphia, the church that patiently endured despite weakness. It's there in verses 7 to 13. Little remains from the ancient Philadelphia. It's once really established until the mid-100s BC. And the city of Philadelphia was the newest of the churches that Jesus addressed in Revelation. I feel a bit uncomfortable with the spiritual weight that was there in Philadelphia at that time. What fantastic words Jesus spoke to them. Verse 8. I know that you have but little power, but yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Oh, to be in a place where our living Christ praises faithful believers and pray, Lord, it's me and you. Jesus also told the church in Philadelphia he would keep them from the hour of trial. But that didn't mean they'd be spared persecution. Accounts report that 11 Christians from Philadelphia were martyred alongside Polycarp in AD 156. It's not easy peasy being a Christian. And the message to Philadelphia shows us the blessings that come when we keep our faith despite what's going on around us, despite our own tribulations, despite the stuff when life is actually pants for us and life goes pear-shaped. In fact, those who persevere despite weaknesses will stand strong as pillars in heaven. Seventhly, almost on the round, Laodicea. The church with a lukewarm faith. Ongoing excavations from the city of Laodicea began only recently, and in 2003, still working there, and the work continues to uncover an expanse, wealthy city. Laodicea was built on a main highway, like you see it there running through. It became a commercial and banking centre. It was known for ear and eye medicine and for its black wool. The water, however, wasn't like this. It wasn't clear and fresh. See, the problem Laodicea had geographically, it didn't have any of this stuff. It didn't have water. Oh, Hugh Lane water makes you cough. And to get water to Laodicea, water had to come on an aqueduct, which was fine. It was getting water. However, by the time it got there, through the heat and everything else, it wasn't like that at all. It was horrible. It was tepid, warmish. It was green. The algae, little buggies were growing in it. Not pleasant at all. However, nearby Hierapolis, it gushed hot thermal springs. Also nearby Colossae, it was the home of pure, clean water. Interestingly, before the city was called Laodicea, it was also called the city of Zeus. So the churches in Hierapolis, Colossae and Laodicea were relatively close to each other, and they seem to have a relationship with each other. Maybe not too unlike what we should be like as a circuit here, but certainly they work together. And Paul instructed that his letter to the Colossians be also read in Laodicea. And also he was encouraged by their strong faith. Paul commended them for the strong faith. But, and it's a big but, something seemed to have changed. In the 30 years or so after Paul's letter to when John penned the book of Revelation, wealth and independence had weakened their commitment to Christ. And Christ rebukes this church for allowing its economic prosperity to cause its spiritual bankruptcy. And he tells them that despite their economic prosperity, economic wealth, only he can provide spiritual wealth. Those in Laodicea's church who open the door to Christ will share in his heavenly banquet and have the right to sit with them on his throne. And Jesus used language and imagery familiar to them. Riches, eye medicine, white clothing, tepid water. And he says in verses 15 to 17, I know your deeds. He knows not just what they do, but he knows the heart that's doing it. I know that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, and I'm going to use the proper word here, not the Englishized, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. It's not spitting, it's a spewing. It's a sicking out of my mouth. You say, I'm rich. I've acquired wealth and I don't need a thing. But you don't realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I think like the Church of Laodicea, it's so easy, isn't it, to become complacent or lukewarm in our faith during times of plenty. And Christ warns us in this letter that he will spew us out. If we are lukewarm, he doesn't want to know. Instead, Jesus urges us to keep seeking the Lord's face and his will, even after his hand has given us so much and blessed us in so many different ways. As we close, I don't think Jesus could have made it any clearer. Following him requires our all, not just a bit of us. The believers of the first century felt the constant pressure to compromise their faith by worshipping the emperor and so on with court worship. They were tolerating false teachers and leading lifestyles that mirrored the pagan world, the culture around them. I wonder, has anything really changed in the past 2,000 years? Okay, we may not have neighbourhood temples, but Christians today feel pressures to compromise in similar ways, don't they? Don't we? Discipleship of Christ is serious stuff that requires an unrelenting commitment to our only Lord, and that Lord can only be Jesus. We must always choose the way of the cross and endure to the end. I pray that we take on board what Jesus said to those churches then, apply it to our own lives and apply it to our own church, so that we may indeed meet together one day in glory and proclaim him the risen Lamb. Amen. as we prepare to come round the table. We're going to sing How Deep the Father's Love for Us. Again, we come and we break bread, we share wine. What's remarkable, one of the remarkable things is that 2,000 years ago, the churches we've spoke about this morning were doing the same thing. Maybe similar, very similar words. Paul passed on the message to them. So we're not doing this as something new. It's something which is dead, as I've done this, gone through the test of time. Maybe as we share bread and wine this morning, we think of those other Christians who today will be doing exactly the same as we are. Yeah, those in Ukraine, those in Israel, the Christians in Gaza, Christians in Sudan, the Christians throughout the world, where they're not sitting here thinking, what's on the lunch menu today? They're thinking, will we still be here this time tomorrow? What have they done with my family? Where's my boy? Where's my girl? Where's my mum? Where's my dad? Yet they'll still come and worship. Maybe as we get to grasp, we'll start to get to grasp with how fantastic, how almighty, how brilliant our God is. Before we share bread and wine, as individuals, we just need time to spend alone with God. and say sorry. The times we messed up, the times we've not listened to him, the times we've put him as a almost as a footnote to our lives, the times we haven't stood up and proclaimed his truth when we know we should. So let us, in the quiet, say sorry. Let's repent and promise that we do want to change. Let's remember that the letter to the churches for the Christians, people like me and you, and what Jesus says to them, to the church in Laodicea. He says, those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. So be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat him, and eat with him, and he with me. The one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Father, open our ears, open our hearts and minds, and help us to listen. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we close this morning, I alluded, when I was preaching, to a wonderful, beautiful song. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon the throne. Let's sing.
Oh,
for thou, Son of God, Messiah, has died for me. Father, as we go out into this world, it is dark. We pray that we can take your light with us. Let's remember not only the warnings you gave to your churches in Revelation, but the rewards as well. Let's remember, Lord, that as we go out, you love each one of us and you want us to be your people. So give us the encouragement, give us the courage to be just that. And may your blessing, the blessing of our Lord God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with us all and shape each one of us now and forever. Amen.